Welcome, everyone.
Okay.
We're going to begin this evening by standing and saying a Pledge of Allegiance to the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you, and welcome to everyone, to Mr. Sigler, Mr. Morgan, my fellow league members, raise your hand, some of us are here this evening, and all of the participants.
Thank you for coming this evening.
Okay. I'm going to begin by just telling you a little bit about the league. And the League of Women Voters was founded in, would you believe, 1920, the original league, after a 72-year struggle to gain women's right to vote. The initial purpose of the league was to help educate 20 million women faced with new rights and responsibilities. Of course, the priorities have changed over the years, but we're still, our main goals are promoting the informed and active participation of citizens in government, and that is so critical for our democracy right now. An informed public is very, very critical, so we thank you for asking us to hold this forum today. Another goal, increasing the understanding of major public policy issues and influencing the public policy through education and advocacy. When was our local league formed? In 2003. So we're, what, 14 years old? It was formed to accomplish the league's mission in our county. And so we do the same thing. We also work to promote informed and active participation, understanding of major public policy issues, influencing public policy through education. The kinds of things that we do are we register voters because we need to have people vote. Unfortunately, in our country, we don't have a high percentage of people who go to the polls, not as compared to other countries. And so we encourage people to vote. And when you go to the voting booth, bring along your neighbors. Try to get as many people there as we can to vote. Sponsor candidate forums, and we thank you for asking us to do this. We also publish this guide to government officials, and we have copies of it here for you. This is the 2017 guide to government officials for citizens of Queen Anne County, so take one on your way out, okay? We publish a pamphlet called Guide to Government Officials for Queen Anne's County, and we monitor activities of county, state, and federal governments. I think I forgot the voter's guide. Yes, we also publish the voter's guide, which most people find very helpful. Is there anything I forgot, Jean?
No.
Okay, thank you. All right, so we encourage people to become members. We have some forms here that you can complete. If you're interested in becoming a member, we really do welcome, even if you're not a member, we welcome you to our meetings. The meetings are on Mondays. It's the second Monday of the month. Mm-hmm. And we've been holding the meetings at the Centreville Library, little conference room there, and so we encourage people to attend, to learn as much as you can about us, and to support us, okay? At this time, I'm going to turn the meeting over to our president, Barbara Sharkey, who's going to also be the moderator today.
Right.
Okay, Barbara.
Thank you, Pat.
All right.
So, I'm just going to give you a little explanation of the format that we're going to follow tonight. We're going to start with each one of the candidates giving a little background for himself, and each one of them has 2 minutes to do that. After that, we have four questions that the candidates have been given ahead of time, and they are in your program, so you can follow along with them. And they also will have 2 minutes to answer. Each one of them will have 2 minutes to answer that question. After that, we will open the floor for questions from the audience. And when that happens, we ask you to come up to the microphone and tell who you are and where you live. And you have 1 minute to ask your question. And we ask you to keep it, refrain from personal comments and personal experiences. Keep it more general, that relate to Centreville and that the whole audience would be interested in hearing. So we also want to thank Queen Anne's County TV for filming tonight. When you do come up here, make sure that you do speak into the microphone. You'll be on TV. And we thank Ted McNeil for our cameraman tonight. So with that, now we did a coin toss to determine who was going to go first. And Mr. Morgan won. So Mr. Morgan, if you would like to start with your 2 minute, let me introduce the timers. Jean Moore and Carolyn Moore said are our timers, so they're going to keep us on time. And they have little signs, so even when you, if you get up to ask a question, they will make sure that you stick to your 1 minute, and they'll hold up a little sign if you're, as you're down to 30 seconds or 15 seconds. Okay, so be aware of that. Sorry, Mr. Morgan.
Okay, hello, I'm Jeff Morgan. I grew up in Annapolis, Maryland. I worked for the Annapolis Fire Department for over 25 years. Promoted up through the ranks. I retired as a battalion chief. In 2008, I moved to Centreville, and I currently live in Centreville with my wife, and we have three daughters. Currently, one daughter lives at home. The other two are out on their own. They both actually live in the area, so they're locals. Just to let you know, I'm here to kind of give another view and let other people vote for, give them a choice to vote for. Not just have one person run and not have a chance to vote. So, I'm here. I appreciate your vote. If you feel like voting for me, I appreciate it. But I hope you come out and vote anyway. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Siegler?
Thank you. I'm Smokey Siegler. A lot of you know me. I've been your council member for the past 6 years. I've been a resident of Centreville since 1992. Raised both of my children here. This is our home. It's been my home. As a matter of fact, my daughter, who will graduate from high school, just left her high school softball game to come and set in. And hopefully we'll be casting a vote, her first ever, on April 3rd. I saw a word the other day called persevere. To continue in a course of action, even in the face of difficulty. We have a development that's having some difficult problems right now. And we're aware of it. Unfortunately, there are some situations there, but I think I may have a partial solution to that. I've done some research on a project called public issuance of debt. We're either managed through the town or through a Maryland Environmental Service that could repair or replace failing sewer systems with using the town's lower borrowing rates, which means that these could be paid for and then repaid back through the town or through your state taxes in an incremental financing that would be placed as an additional tax. What I would like to do is form a working group, and I would certainly encourage those living in Northbrook to serve on this work group to figure out how we can get through this difficult time that we've been having. I appreciate being your council member. I look forward to continuing being your council member. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So we're going to alternate who goes first with each question. So since Mr. Morgan went first, Mr. Siegler, you are the first one to answer the first of the prepared questions. And as I said, it's in your brochure. So the question is, what are the important issues facing the town of Centreville? Mr. Siegler?
Thank you. In one word, continuity. Centreville is functioning well now. We are financially stable. We are focused on infrastructure repairs and improvements. We're creating the environment to attract commercial investments. We are focused on providing critical services to our residents, and maintaining our focus on these are very important for us to move Centreville forward. Thank you.
Mr. Morgan?
Okay. I agree with Mr. Siegler in infrastructure. Maintenance, upgrades, and replacement is very important. That's what we pay taxes for. That's what we expect. That's why you moved to Centreville, because you wanted city water, city sewers. So that's one of my big issues. I have a problem a little bit with the council and overspending, and I will bring one example to light. They purchased a property not too long ago, I believe last year, on 105 North Liberty Street, and they paid way over the price for that building. They paid $880,000 for it. You can go to the Maryland tax site, and you can see that that building is appraised at $544,000. So they paid $335,000 over the asking price for that property. I kind of have a problem with that. We don't have much money as it is. We're a small town. We can't afford to be wasting money and just throwing money away. I'm sure that you wouldn't go out and buy a house that was worth $250,000 and pay $500,000 for that same house. So, you know, I have the paperwork here if you'd like to look at it. If not, you can go online and be more than glad to look at it. I have both the town ordinance and the MDAT, the information. I also believe in timely completion of projects at or below bid prices. I know they've been working on Kidwell a very long time. I'm sure the residents aren't too happy with that. One thing I'd like to see is projects completed before or at time and on budget pricing. Another thing that I like to see, and I tell you about this with Annapolis, is looking at a rainy day fund for when unforeseen items come up that there's a budget for that amount in case you need it. So I appreciate it. Those are my big 4 points. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, the second question is, how would you increase the commercial economic viability of the town? And Mr. Morgan, you're first on this one.
I actually got a chance. I looked at the economic development plan that was a study was done in September of 2015 by the town of Centreville, and I believe that they should go ahead and continue with the recommendations in that plan where practical and where feasible budget-wise. One of the things I saw they put in there was there were a lot of upfront fees, impact fees for businesses and all when they were building in the town. And one way to take care of, to help out with that is to, same thing you do with, you know, water and sewer, is do it over a course of time, not hit them at all at one time, so you can make them pay over a 5-year, 10-year, 15-year period. The town will get the money. One of the recommendations was to delete it all together, but I don't think that's fair. I think everybody needs to pay their fair share when it comes to utilities and such. Another thing I think you need to do is you need to grow the tax base. And one way you grow the tax base is not by purchasing properties by the town, the county, or the state, because there's no income taxes in that. Believe me, I grew up in Annapolis, and there was a lot of state buildings, county buildings in the city of Annapolis that the city did not receive taxes for. So every time the town buys a building, that's tax money you lose. That's tax base you lose because the town's not taxing themselves. So I think that's a big thing they need to look at. Thank you.
Mr. Siegler?
I've been doing this for my entire 6 years in office. Countless meetings. I'm a member of the Queen Anne's County Economic Development Council. We created legislation to form the Centreville Economic Development Authority. We obtained Centreville Main Street status, grants to do facade improvements. We've gotten two of those at $50,000. Taking meetings with prospective commercial investors. Just last week, I met with a Canadian circuit board company that wants to expand their business from Toronto closer to DC. We're the only location they looked at on the Eastern Shore. This is white business, and they're looking at an empty building that's set empty since it's been built 10 years ago. And they would like to move into that building if everything works out. They want to. I have served on the Parks Board for pushing ways that we can improve our parks so the people who come here can do what everybody wants to do, and that's pushing for live, work, and play in the same environment. And I just want to add one thing to Mr. Morgan's comment about the county building. That was purchased by the county because they had to provide parking for their 41,000 square foot parking deck that they did not build with the new county courthouse. So those dollars came straight from the county. They were not purchased with town funds. And that's all I have.
Okay, thank you. The third question is, please explain the tax differential and whether it is important to Centreville. And Mr. Siegler, you're first on this question.
Thank you, and I'm going to try to do this in 2 minutes. I brought with me a copy of my real property tax bill. We all get them in the mail. If you get them, when you go back, pull it up and look at it under assessed value. You'll see a line in there that says total property tax. Mine for last year was 2787. There's a line below that that says municipal tax rebate. Before I came on the council, you didn't have that line on your taxes. The tax differential is broken down into two things: a tax differential that comes back to the citizens, a tax rebate or form of payment that goes directly to the town for services. We just had our meeting with the county this year on March 8th, and very few people show up for this thing. I asked for the full tax burden be paid to the council, to the citizens, of 17.2 cents this year. Last year we got 8.4, the year before that we got 5.4. I have pushed for this since I came on the council. We are moving this forward, and the data's on your tax bill that it's working. So, thank you.
Okay, could I rebut one thing that Mr. Sigler said before?
Can you save it?
Okay, I can save it.
All
That's
right.
Fine. All right. In reference to the tax differential, I understand what that is. It's a rebate on your taxes because you're paying for dual services. The Queen Anne's County has a sheriff's office. Centreville has a police department. Of course, the sheriff doesn't really patrol Centreville that much. I mean, they'll come in to assist, but the town takes care of that. So that's part of your taxes. That's what your differential is. Roads, infrastructure, and stuff like that that's paid for through our town taxes, you get rebates on that. So that's what a tax differential is. And is it important to Centreville? Sure, it's important to Centreville. As a taxpayer, I believe in that also. I don't want to be double taxed on stuff, just like you don't want to be double taxed on stuff. So I agree with Mr. Sigler on that. I think the county should be providing us with the full amount. Hopefully we can get to that point one day.
Good, thank you. Okay, the fourth and last prepared question is, what is your vision for Centreville in 5 to 10 years? And please be specific. And Mr. Morgan, this you're first on this question.
Okay, I believe we should continue with the infrastructure improvements and replacements and schedule those. It needs to be budgeted, it needs to be taken care of, and it needs to be a long journey plan. So it's not something that you can do tomorrow. You know, you have to do these things in increments and you have to budget for them. So that'll take a long time. I believe we should continue to seek economic development and grow the town tax base and business-wise and retail and food services, stuff like that, stuff that's important to the people that live in the community. I believe we should continue checking and overseeing the budget to make sure the taxpayer money is spent wisely and efficiently. I guess I'll use this moment right now. If you go to your SDAT for the state, you'll find out the owners of that property he's talking about is listed as the Town Council of Centreville, so it doesn't belong to the county, it belongs to the town. Also, continue to grow the tax base at a reasonable rate of growth for services available. You can't outgrow yourself, and that's one problem that Centreville has had in the past where they try to put too much stuff onto an infrastructure that couldn't handle it, and they ended up with a build a moratorium. So what we need to do is you need to plan for this growth and make sure you do it over the 5 to 10 year period.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Sigler?
Thank you. Infrastructure maintenance is a regular part of the budget. Clean waterfront and enjoyable parks for families. Financial stability to our budget, greater commercial viability. A water sewer infrastructure that would enable the town to grow at a pace as described in our comprehensive plan. We need to prepare for that growth. This means investing in future needs, expanding the wastewater plant and spray field. In the first year on the council, I championed the installation of a 1 megawatt solar array at the spray farm along the front edge of the buffer area there. That will, tentatively over the life of the solar array, save us taxpayers over $1 million in electric costs at no upfront cost to the town. The more we prepare now, the better position we will be for future growth.
Okay, thank you very much. So we now turn to the audience participation. If anyone has a question that they would like to ask, I just want to remind you, this is an informational forum, and all questions should be addressed to both candidates. Is there any question? Would you come up to the microphone, please?
My name is Roy Sherman. I live at 213 Hope Road up in Centerville Heights. The number two industry in not only Queen Anne's County, but also in the state of Maryland is tourism. And as a, I'm one of the four officers in the Queen Anne's County Economic Development Commission, and I look and see where the tourism is, where the attractions are in Queen Anne's County. And we see Chestertown is turning itself into an artist colony. Stevensville is pretty much the same thing with a historical flair to it. And there's a hole in the center, and that's where Centreville is. My question is, what thoughts and plans or ideas would you have to improve the viability of tourism in the town of Centreville to kind of fill this gap?
Mr. Siegler, would you like to start
sure.
with that?
One of the things that we have done is institute the Main Street program. And through that, we have established Centreville Days to bring tourists into the town. They have been successful. They continue to grow. There is going to be this coming late summer a farm-to-table dinner that will take up the entire length of Lawyers Row, bringing people here to experience what it's like to be in Centreville during this time of the year. Our annual Christmas parade speaks for itself. That brings the biggest crowd to Queen Anne's County on the Eastern Shore during our annual Christmas parade. So that's my thoughts on those ones.
I believe one of the things that Centreville should push is its historic value, the town historic and different things involved in this town. And, you know, history is a big thing in Maryland. And, you know, we were part of the original 13 and we were here during the, you know, the revolution and all that. So I think that's something that should be pushed and it's something that's missing that in this area, I believe. So, and I also believe that the farmers market and items like that, local things should be, you know, pushed in on, downtown and be functions and things that people can come out, bring their families to, get involved in, and enjoy the local fruits of everybody's labor here. So appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any other questions? Yes. Well, we'll see.
One of my concerns is about the tax base.
You need to speak in the mic.
Okay, that means I'm talking to them. Okay, I'm actually going to go to question two first. We have a demographic gap which has impacted the revitalization of downtown. Our young people leave at 17 and they don't come back. What would you do to bring young people back and small business back to our downtown?
Mr. Morgan?
I think one of the things that needs to be looked at is the pricing. I know there are certain people that have tried to come into Centreville with businesses and they're being priced out of the market. They can't afford the rents. So I believe we have to look at some way to help them out with that and make it viable so that people want to come back in here. A lot of people leave because there's not a lot of business around here that they can get involved in. So they go places where they can raise their family and get involved in that stuff. So I think that's something we need to look at and needs to be studied and it also needs to be pushed forward on the town council.
Within the next 18 months, there's going to be fiber optics coming down out of Kent County. The next generation is the technological generation. They live on their cell phones and iPads. With that coming in, we can look at more types of restaurants, gathering places for this demographic who, in a lot of cases, telecommute most of the days of the week and will go across the bridge one or two days a week to do their work. As we develop the infrastructure to handle that, we will find more and more of them staying here. And then by more and more of them staying here, they will drive the development in our downtown and along our growth corridors.
Did you have a second question?
May I? I
think we have
enough
time.
I promise to talk into it this time. My interest is economics. This has been a good year with a warming economy. Infrastructures, projects in process, and the new businesses looking at the business park now as we speak. However, the business roundtable suggests that we have about an 18 to 24 month window of economic improvement, after which there may be a cycling and slowing again of the economy. This is just a natural feature of how the economy works. Our commercial tax base will remain an ongoing concern. In that 2 year window, specifically, what businesses would you attract and how would you go about it?
Okay, Mr. Siegler.
A couple years ago, we were awarded a grant to seek the opinion of the citizens on what do you want. And for those of you who were around back then, you saw those bright, god-awful green signs that basically said, what do you want? And about 900 of you went to the website and filled out this 11-page questionnaire on what you wanted. And the one thing that came through more than anything else is you wanted more and better restaurants. We continue to talk to restaurants. I have personally talked to about 15 different restaurants. We have 17,000 cars a day that go north and south on 213. We're almost at 5,000. The last number was 4974. The demographics are getting there, the communications are getting there, and once that happens, then that growth is going to come along with it. Does that answer your question?
I kind of agree with Mr. Sigler on the, I believe the coffee house theory is probably a good one to bring into town, and what he was saying with the, you know, the technological age, that's what they want. They want to sit in a Starbucks or wherever and, you know, play on their phones, talk to their friends or whatever they're doing, handle their business sometimes. I think that's good. I think the restaurants are, you know, a variety of restaurants are important because, you know, everybody wants something different. Nobody wants, you know, the same stuff all the time. And I also think maybe some of the boutique stores in the area would be nice, you know, bring in some type of different stores that, you know, make a shopping area or something like that where people want to travel to Centreville to shop, sort of like Annapolis downtown. You know, people go to downtown to look at the boutique stores and they get a lot of tourism through that. So that might be something to look at.
Good evening, my name is Rick Bowers and I live at 270 Northfield Way in Centreville. And thank you, gentlemen, for taking this time out of your schedule to serve the rest of us. We appreciate it. My question, I guess, is going to impact each of you differently. Your answers are going to be based on your exposure or during that situation. But, Mr. Morgan, you mentioned the road repairs at Kidwell. We had a few years ago, you may remember, in front of the courthouse. Seemed like it took us maybe 6-8 months. I also understand we paid a night differential so the court didn't have to be disturbed. And, you know, I find a lot of heartburn in some of the overages, particularly when I call and I'm told, well, there were some unexpected situations. We didn't know what was underneath. It leaves me few options to really be settled with as to why that wouldn't be known. But here's my question. With Kidwell now extending, I was told it's an 18-month program and there are several streets involved. I still don't understand why it takes us so long. So my question to you is, I guess maybe to Mr. Sigler, help me wrap my head around that. And to Mr. Morgan, would you, if elected, because we know that the current council, well, if you are, then you can answer this as well, but are you bidding contracts with some contingencies in there, some rewards for under budget, early completion, anything along those lines to get them out of our neighborhood and on to the next job?
Mr. Morgan.
I believe that's an important thing to include in bids, to have early incentives so the builder, you know, or the construction companies have incentives to finish on time or even before on time. And I think that's important. People don't want to be disrupted for a long period of time and then turn around and find out that, oh, there's something unexpected occurred.
But would you put it in the bidding?
Oh, I most definitely would. I would have something in the bidding for that. That would definitely be, you know, and that would be part of the thing. And they went over, they would be, you know, there would be fines for that, just as any other building project usually is fined for being over. So
it's a standard part of the contract, what you're asking for. I will give you some background on just one street, Broadway, the biggest connector in Centreville. It's got 51 bus passes across it every day. It's also one of the oldest streets in Centreville. And you would think that a 120-foot street would have been done early. There were old service station pumps fouled under the streets. There were sewer pipes that had over 7 bands of corrections on them. So when we do this, we have to go down to the base. We have to take everything out. We have to repair everything, all the mains, all the laterals that have to go off to the sides. And then we have to go back in and fill it. We have to put curbs, gutters, first course, second course, and finish courses. And those things take time. And when you're talking about a multi-street project, it takes a longer time, usually around 8 months to go from start to finish. They start to work when it's cooler, so that they can finish when it's time to lay the asphalt, and that way it finishes up before school starts.
So then we need to maybe include some background prior to actually engaging in the process so that we know what's underneath.
That background is done every time we put something out
to
bid.
We should have known about, I don't want to take everybody's time here.
Right, exactly.
That would have been part and parcel with...
We're dealing in a street that was, that in a city that was started in 1794. And some of the infrastructure in this city goes back to the 30s and 40s. We still have certain parts of this city, and I know I'm going to get offline here, but I want you to understand why, that still have clay sewer pipes under them because the infrastructure was not done when it should have been done. And now we have to play catch up. In 2018, the state highway is going to come through Centreville, replace both bridges, replace Centreville, Commerce, and Liberty Street at the same time. If you're concerned with traffic like you were during the accident when you called town hall, brother, you ain't seen nothing yet. So, and that's where I'm going to end it on that. Okay?
Thanks very much. May I get a second question? Get back in line and have a second question.
Yeah, sure. Okay.
Good afternoon or good evening. The questions that have been asked recently in the last few minutes.
Could you give your name and address?
Oh, sorry, Mary Margaret Revelle Goodwin, and I live on Commerce Street. The questions that have been asked most recently give me an indication that at least from the perspective of some of those asking the questions are slightly unaware of the history of this town. I would like to hear from each of you, but of course Mr. Siegler has had so much experience now, plus Mary Margaret hammering him constantly on his head. That's why he's without a lot of hair. Because about not just the history, and he mentioned one of the aspects, Commerce Street, which you see hundreds and hundreds, thousands of cars going up and down the street all the time. Still, there are clay pipes, sewer pipes, even now, even right now, that were the first pipes put in. The streets were not even paved until 1914. So what I'd like to know is, how many times have you been, not just to town council, but, and Mr. Siegler's been, of course, with already being there, but how often have you been at town meetings, not just the town council, but to the various other committee meetings and so forth, so that you have an understanding of the history? I'm sorry.
You're right.
I'm sorry. Everybody knows once I get going on history.
So it's
hard to show.
It's Mr. Siegler's turn to answer first.
Let me see if I can remember where we started. I do know there's an ordinance still on the books that we kept as we review the ordinance from time to time that go back a long way. For those of you who still drive your oxen carts to town, you can't park them on the streets after 3 p.m. on Friday. Okay, so just to let you know. Before I started this quest to become a council member, I attended over a year's worth of council meetings, planning commission meetings, park board meetings, cemetery board meetings. And this is a very steep learning curve. We are already starting into our new budget year. And if you don't have your ducks together walking in the door, you're going to be way behind the power curve.
Okay. Mr. Morgan?
Well, one issue I have with that is evidently there wasn't much planning on which streets they were going to start with and which were more important. There should have been a chart that said this street is the worst and should be the first. So, you know, if you still have clay pipes under your street, that's an issue. I am the president of the Northbrook HOA Association, so I handle a lot of stuff. I've met with Tim Mikulski several times and Steve Walls, and I've been to several town council meetings, especially when we had the water issues where the water rates rose and all, just like everybody else, wasn't happy about it. But I haven't been to the other meetings, and I will make attempts to go to those meetings and understand. And you know, if elected, I will be more than sure to get out and talk to the constituents and see what's important and what you need. You know, you need to talk to everybody. You know, this town is, like you said, almost 5,000 people, so everybody's voice should be heard.
Well, just one tiny comment, if I'm permitted, or not.
Half a minute. Go ahead.
No, I have. Northbrook was built on the property of one of the most prominent men in the state of Maryland who got us through the Revolutionary War. So,
thank you.
Thank you very much. And for 6 years, she has reminded me of that.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Tim Kinks, and I'm actually from Graysonville, but I play a little politics. So, my question to both of you gentlemen is your commitment to Centreville. I know I've had conversations with Mr. Ziegler in the past. He's indicated that he wants to run for county council. And I know that this term is a 3-year term, and I know with our conversation before, Mr. Morgan, you have a commitment, 25-year commitment for firefighting. Hope you bring that to here with the town. But if elected, either of you, would you stay and commit to the citizens for your full term, or do you plan to run for county commissioner?
Mr. Ziegler, I think it's your...
I have made a commitment to this community since before you moved over here, my friend. I have lived here since 1992. This wasn't my first rodeo. I spent 12 years serving this community as the commander of the American Legion here in town. I continue to serve in those capacities as a commandant of the Marine Corps League. I have always served this community in one form or the other, and I will continue to serve this community throughout the duration of my next election. What did I say? What did I say?
I don't know.
Then you were not paying attention. Thank you very much.
I just heard a lot of words.
Well, that's fine.
Mr. Morgan?
I've elected. Of course, I'll be here for the 3-year term. That's my plan. I want to get on the council. I want to be on the council, and I want to make a difference. I want to try and, you know, help, you know, take care of some of this overspending and monies that are going elsewhere where they shouldn't be going. So, yes, I will be here for the 3-year term.
Thank you.
Just so you understand the words, stop a minute, sir, and pay me the respect of turning around. I will be here for the next 3 years.
Thank you. That was a question.
And thank you for turning your back on me.
Good evening.
Okay, next question.
My name is Kathy Magruder Beecham. I live at 205 Green Street. I just, first of all, want to say to both of you that I applaud your willingness to stand up and participate in public service. It's a thankless job sometimes, and I appreciate that you're willing to take that on. My question is with regard to budget priorities. Mr. Morgan, you specifically referenced the budget and how you, what I want to know is, what is the Centreville town budget? How would you prioritize the expenditures? What are the priorities that you see a limited source of revenue should be used for? You both also referenced economic development and the importance of pursuing that for the town. What kind of investment do you think should be made monetarily to achieve the goals that you outlined in your previous comments?
Mr. Morgan?
In reference to what is the budget, it's over $3 million. I have a copy of the budget with me right here. Yeah, you know, I'm sure you've seen it also. I think one of the biggest things is infrastructure. I think that's going to be your biggest problem. If something goes wrong on your street, your sewer goes out, your water goes out, that's going to be the most important thing to you as a community. And that's why you're here in Centreville. I do believe that the business and economic growth is important, but I think one of the things they need to work on right now is the infrastructure. Get that up to where it needs to be. As Mr. Ziegler said, there's a lot of streets around here that aren't up to code, that need to be brought up to code. And I think we need to come up with a plan to handle that and take care of these issues.
Thank you. Mr. Ziegler.
He's a little shy on the budget. The number's closer to $6 million. And we continue to look at that every year. My first year on the council, I formed a budget advisory committee to advise us on the best ways to move our budget forward, to make sure that we were getting the bang out of our budget. That advisory council still meets to this day, and several of those members are in this room. we continually evaluate our budget on how we can do things better. We're moving some of our funds around into better saving programs so we get larger returns on those investments, and we will continue to do that moving forward.
I don't think either of you answered the question about how much money you think we should spend on business development.
I can take that. We budgeted about $10,000 for a part-time economic development person. That number should be closer to $50,000, so we could hire somebody more on a full-time basis. But like with everything else that we deal with, we've got to find money in the budget to do that with.
Mr. Morgan, would you agree with that?
I think one of the issues in the economic development plan was pointed out that they should use Queen Anne County business community to try and work on that. And they did recommend a part-time person. But I think that's the first thing they need to do. They need to go to Queen Anne's County and start getting a little bit of help from them and then move on from there. But I do think business is important and tax growth is important also. But I do believe infrastructure is one of the main goals of the budget right now.
You referenced infrastructure, water, sewer under your street. You mentioned that you're from Northbrook. I know that Northbrook residents have some problems with grinder pumps going under. Do you believe that the town should finance the improvements for the private homeowners in Northbrook?
I don't believe they should finance. I believe the thing that Mr. Sigler pointed out earlier about the lower interest rate loans that are available should be taken care of. But I think there are some issues in Northbrook that were presented by the council by allowing some of this stuff to be put in. There's a lot of substandard sewage and sewage piping and all in Northbrook that was put in on this town. And you know what? It's the town's responsibility. They should have been there to look at it to make sure it met the approvals, and they should have took care of it. And now they need to take care of it now. That's the issue. That's why we have councilmen come out there. I've never seen Mr. Sigler out there. I've seen Mr. Mikulski out there, though.
Okay, thank you.
Hello, I'm Mary Alice O'Connor. I live on Churchill Road near the Methodist Church. I have no questions about budgets. I can't add two and two. But what I am concerned about is Centreville's recycling. A year ago, the council signed up with a new contractor. And, you know, because I wasn't paying much attention, I have to admit. The new contractor doesn't take half as many things as the old one did. Now, is that really economically feasible? Don't we pay bulk for waste, regular waste, garbage?
Okay, I forget which is going first.
Do you understand me?
Yes, ma'am.
Why is the new contract for recycling so much less than the old?
I think it has to do with the way that they evaluate the recycling. We had a meeting with them last week, Steve. We brought them in because we were dissatisfied with their service.
It's a year.
And, well, they were actually very good when they first started. And they've gotten a little worse.
You're not answering my question.
And I'm going to, and I'm trying to get there. There are certain types of recyclings, and I was not aware that if you put letters and newspapers and magazines in a plastic bag and then put that plastic bag in your recycling, they can't take that plastic bag. It has to go in loose. And those are the kind of things that we have asked them to provide to us so we can, in one of our email blasts, send out to the residents what they can and cannot recycle.
That's not the point.
But
both contractors took mixed paper, newspapers, cardboard. That's
and they continue to do that, but
yes,
not
right.
Just that.
And nobody was supposed to put anything in a plastic bag, but the new contractor doesn't take the paper egg cartons, doesn't take the plastic tubs that we all get, like with margarine, yogurt, hummus, you name it. They don't take aluminum foil, they don't take pie pans now, they don't take the paper milk things, the juice boxes. That's a lot of garbage.
So the question is?
So what's the point? Are we saving money that way? Because you're putting it into the trash.
Ma'am, all we can do is get back to you on specifics on that, and we will certainly be happy to do that because we just met with them last week to get this ironed out. Okay? And if you would see me afterwards so I can get your contact information, so I will call you back.
Good. Thank you. Do you?
I think they should take whatever they agreed upon in the past on the contract, and if they're not doing what they're supposed to be doing, they should pay some type of penalty and be taken care of.
I'm sorry, that wasn't. No, they are doing what they're, as far as I'm concerned.
Well, according to Mr. Sigler, they're not. They're not doing what they're supposed to be doing.
The second contract was not as inclusive as the first.
Okay, well, as somebody coming in, I would have to look at that, and we'd have to work on that and get the contract straightened out so everything was taken. I can also tell you with the refuge that we had trash put out on the side of the street that was overlooked by the trash company. It wasn't picked up in Northbrook, that I had to go down to town hall and get somebody to make a phone call to have them come back and pick it up. So there is an issue with that.
I have not complained about my trash or anything.
Well, I can tell you it has been an issue.
Okay. Next question.
Good evening again. My name is Rick Bowers. I have a two-part question, kind of Northbrook centric, but forgive me, but that's where I live. But first thing, you know, at the speed limit, we recently, well, over the last few years, put in a red light right there at Spaniard's Neck, Eden Dairy. But we also have another situation that kind of is in conflict with that, because we have a new red light, but we also have a situation where we come down a little bridge and we're told to speed up to 50, which sort of puts in your mind you're going to continue on. But then we're asking them to stop at the red light a few thousand yards away. So we're kind of giving them the wrong impression. Would either of you consider, like the rest of the city, treating Northbrook as if we're a member of the city and part of that main thoroughfare, as we do have a 35 mile an hour speed limit at the south end? We should have it up to the city limits out of courtesy to us, Northbrook citizens. Secondly, I talked to a lot of Northbrook citizens, and no one knew about a macerator attached to their home before they purchased their home. Maybe many of you don't know about macerators, but it's a, you know, several thousand dollar ticking time bomb that basically, if the alarm goes off, you cannot utilize your home anymore because you have 30 gallons of fresh water left, and that's it. So it's a real issue. So would either of you be willing to investigate that travesty?
Mr. Morgan?
I think the first thing that should be looked at, I believe in lowering the speed limit some. I don't know whether I'd go to the full 35. I might go to ask for 45 on that stretch to the traffic light, and then from there, speed up. I agree with you. The traffic light was fought for a long time by Northbrook. It was part of the development. It took a long time to get put in.
And it's a good thing.
So, oh, yes, it is. Very good thing.
I just think it's counterintuitive when people are told to speed up, and then if you're not paying attention, you know, you're not really expecting to have to stop within 30 seconds of being told to speed up.
Yeah, it's something that needs to be looked at, definitely. The second thing, yeah, I would put somebody together, because from what I understand, when those were put in for the sewer issues that they had, because Northbrook was put on a moratorium on building because of the sewer issue, where they were actually pumping sewage into the Corsica River. Mm-hmm. And the town manager and the town council, I believe, were all let go over that issue, and that, you know, the town wasn't happy about it, of course. So I believe that's something that needs to be looked at. Did we get the cheapest thing that they could find for us to put in our homes? And maybe we need to look at that and see what remedies there are. And I also know that the company that is the proprietary company for the grinder pumps has held Northbrook hostage for a long time over that. And they've been telling people lies when they come out there on Sundays when you're paying them double time, and telling you that they're the only company that can put these pumps in and purchase the pumps through. And that's not just true. And that came from the town. So we need to correct that also.
Absolutely. By the way, for those of you who do not know, your macerator is about $3,000 to replace. And at any given time, if they come out for a call, the cheapest I've ever heard was about $800, like that.
Hey, Mr. Sigler, would you like to comment?
Sure. On the 35, we could certainly approach State Highway about that, as we did with the residents in Symphony Village requesting the speed limit be lowered out there.
Would you do that?
Yes, absolutely. Okay. Sure. And we have done that before, and we could do that again. And it probably makes sense.
How would we do it differently, though? Because we want to win this time.
We won the last time. The speed limit was reduced out there, Rick.
No, not up to the corner, north corner.
Right. But we have to work with State Highway. It's a state highway. Okay. And it took the town over 2 years to get them to reduce the speed limit bridge to bridge from 35 to 25. And when we're dealing with State Highway, mm-hmm. we're dealing with State Highway. And it takes a long time to get them to do anything. I have a macerator pump in my basement. I bought the house from an estate. Didn't know what it was until the first time the alarm went off, okay? My house was built in 1971. I called my plumber. He came out and he said, it's one of three things. Either it's jammed, it's burn up, or you have a plug in your line. He pulled it out, found that it was jammed, fixed the jam, put it back in, and I haven't had a problem since, okay? I sympathize with Northbrook's situation.
What
with
did
this.
That cost you, though, by the way?
Oh, back in those days,
oh,
I think...
Was, oh, that was long, I never mind.
Yeah, this has been a long time ago. It has happened a couple more times since then, but it's basically, and we're not going to tell you what they are, but...
Well, because in Northbrook, Freemeyer holds us hostage, and it is about $700 to $800 minimum.
And as I said, there should be a way that we can sit down with a work group and work through that and try to fix that.
Thank you, gentlemen. Mm-hmm.
I think we have time for one more question.
Roy Sherman, again. Anyway, I thought of another one. You both had discussed expanding the restaurant business in Centreville. That's pretty much a given if you want to increase your tourism and your traffic through the town. I spent 40 years in sales and marketing in the restaurant business, so believe me, I know what the issues are. A couple of us have been discussing in the county economic development. What one of the main problems is, and as you probably noticed, you don't see an Olive Garden or a Lone Star Steakhouse or a restaurant like that in this this county. And the reason is our liquor laws. Probably, I don't know how long ago it happened, but there was a certain restaurant operator that managed to push through some liquor laws that said that there has to be, one of the principal owners has to be a resident of Queen Anne's County. And we're looking into the possibility of trying to get that changed at the county level. Can we count on the town of Centreville to stand behind us on that one?
Absolutely. Jeffrey Thompson, one of the attorneys who sets on the County Liquor Control Board. We still had an old blue law on the books that affected Centreville that if you were within 200 feet of a church or a library, you couldn't serve liquor. It took, I've been here since 1992 until this past year, to get that blue law taken off the books, and it finally has. So the things can be done. It's just when they're not important enough in Annapolis to perk to the top over there, they keep getting lost in committees, and that was what happened to this one. But if we keep putting pressure on them, we keep calling those guys, we keep meeting with our elected representatives over there, then we can get stuff done.
Okay. I agree. If that's important, and I agree, you know, there should be liquor laws that allow for that type of business in these areas. And so I agree with that. Yes, the town council should do something.
Thanks, Royce.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I didn't get a chance.
Oh, you have a question. Is that what you were saying? You have a question? Okay, we have one more question.
Okay, so I'm Jean Moore, and I live on Chesterfield Avenue right out here. And, I've seen the barber shop getting torn down and the other shop getting torn down, and then there's this big courthouse behind them. And when you were looking at the architectural drawings, it was this beautiful big long lawn in front of the courthouse, which isn't going to be there. Then the town has bought that old church and they're going to turn it into a parking lot. I'm really concerned about the streetscapes in Centreville. If you keep tearing things down and putting up parking lots, you know, they tore down something and put up a parking lot, we're not going to have any of our history left. We've tried several times, I and several other people in town, to get a historic district ordinance that says you can't do that, or you have to at least get permissions and things. So my question to you is, how do you feel about some kind of historic district ordinance in Centreville?
Mr. Morgan.
I believe it's something that the council should look at. I think history in any area is important, and you have to, you know, remember your history. And as I said before, I think the historic area would be an important draw on tourism. So it's something that should be looked at and should be studied and taken a look at by the council and then voted on accordingly.
It would have to go through planning and zoning, Gene, like everything else does. And it certainly can be revisited. Just because it didn't pass before doesn't mean we can't look at it again to see about that. But there are some pitfalls to historic districts and regulations on houses and housing and everything else.
You can't paint your house
Right.
That's not a problem. It's tearing down that old historic church and putting a parking lot. I mean, you know, that contributes to stormwater runoff.
As does the building we're setting in here, Jean.
Yes,
and as do the other 35 governmental buildings that reside in this town. They pay no taxes to do anything in town to the tune of $308,000 a year. Okay, I'm on your side, Jean. Okay.
Great. All right, thank you very much. Great questions, everybody. We've reached the almost the end of our program, and we're going to take 2 minutes to allow each one of the candidates to give a wrap-up, whatever he wants to say, and we will start with Mr. Sigler.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming out. Thank you all for listening. Thank you for your questions. I hope I was able to answer them somewhat coherently. Like I said, I've been here for 25 years. Centreville's my home. It will continue to be my home. My daughter and my son were both raised here. I like this town. I have seen it grow from what my wife and I moved here from North Carolina, called it Mayberry of the North, where the sidewalks basically closed down at 5 o'clock, as did all the businesses. And we still have that to a degree on the square because it's mostly governmental buildings, but we're moving away with that with the new comprehensive plan, with the growth pattern going out 304. We're getting more infill with businesses that are coming to Centreville. If we can do something downtown with the CBD, expand on that into a historic district like you talked, Gene, any of those things are possible. We just have to have community and city and personnel involvement to do that. I get so frustrated in a council meeting when I look out over an empty room and see nobody there weeks after weeks. And I know they're boring, but every now and then we get a jewel. So I want to continue trying to do this. So I'm asking for your support for re-election on April 3rd. And thank you so much for coming out tonight.
Thank you. Mr. Morgan?
Well, first of all, I'd like to thank everybody for allowing us this forum to express our views and our opinions on what we see for the town of Centreville. Personally, I hope it continues to grow and flourish. I live here. I moved here in 2008. I plan on staying here. I enjoy this town. I enjoy the area. I agree more restaurants will be nice to be able to go to and partake in different things. And I also, like I said, I just believe that, you know, even if you don't elect me, I hope the council has their eyes open to see what's important to the community. And I think one of the important things, as I've stated before, is the infrastructure issues that need to be taken care of. I think the rainy day fund needs to be put in place. And I think you need to stop raising taxes and start spending like everybody else does. You can't go to your boss or whoever and say, hey, I have more expenses, I need a raise. They're not going to do that. And we need to let them know that, you know what, you have money to work with. You get increases when the tax revenues go up on the real estate and stuff like that. You need to work within your budgets. And that's what I'm hoping to bring. And hopefully, you know, I'm giving you a choice. You know, if you like things the way they are, feel free to vote for Mr. Sigler. If you don't like things the way they are, maybe you can send a message and vote me in. But, you know, either way, I hope you come out and vote on April 3rd because it is important. It's an important process, and I hope everybody comes out. And please vote Jeff Morgan for a change. Thank you.
Thanks, man.
Very good. Thank you, Mr. Morgan and Mr. Sigler, and thank you all for coming tonight. And I hope that you do get out and vote on April 3rd and invite your neighbors and make sure you get the word out that there is an election this year. And I want to also make a special thank you to Queen Anne's County TV for covering this debate, this forum, and you can all watch it on your televisions or your computers.